Hello, I'm Miles O'Brien, the science correspondent for the PBS NewsHour. We're just days away from a historic presidential election that will test the various ways that we vote in this country with stakes that really cannot get any higher. For the past 5 months, my team and I have crisscrossed the nation. We've been speaking with secretaries of state, election directors, computer scientists, election security experts. Our aim was to better understand the technologies and techniques that we use to vote and see if they are, in fact, up to the challenge. In the midst of this pandemic, there's been an avalanche of mail-in and absentee voters, as well as early voting. And in some cases, this is coupled with jurisdictions that are testing brand new technology for in-person voting. It's a prescription for a potential meltdown, as we saw in June in Georgia. It was no walk in the park when Georgians cast their ballots on June 9th. Many voters, disproportionately Democrats and African Americans, spent 6 to 8 hours in line, patient yet piqued. At the Central Park Rec Center in Atlanta, I met Amelia Dobbs 4 hours into a grueling vote-a-thon.
So I'm very disappointed after being a voter for over 50 years. It's getting worse, worse, and worse. It can't get any worse than this.
John Dotson and his partner Yolanda Boris were just ahead of Ms. Dobbs in a line that encircled the park. They were livid.
It is 9:56. There are now eight ballots counted.
Scanned.
Eight ballots. This is an exercise in patience, yeah. but also it's an exercise in will. And if the intention is to break the will, this will, those people are not leaving.
Inside, beleaguered poll workers struggled with a new, complex voting system that they hadn't even seen before the election. In-person training was deemed unsafe in the midst of a pandemic. Among other things, the passwords to log onto the machines, in plain view on the tables, didn't work. Marilyn Marks is executive director of the Coalition for Good Governance, an organization focused on election transparency and verifiability.
We don't necessarily have fair and secure elections across the United States. And Georgia is the epitome of problem elections. Georgia becomes really the example at almost every level of what is wrong.
Marks helped lead the charge to usher in a new era of voting in Georgia last year. For 18 years, the state used electronic voting machines made by Diebold Election Systems. The machines were widely used across the nation, even though experts proved they were easy for hackers to attack without leaving a trace.
A federal judge is ordering Georgia to stop using its outdated voting machines and...
In August of 2019, a federal judge ordered the state to scrap the flawed machines for something more secure and verifiable. So the state spent more than $100 million to supply every county with so-called image cast machines made by a Canadian company, Dominion Voting Systems. They are ballot marking devices, meaning voters make selections on a touchscreen, and ballots are printed with choices embedded in a QR code and listed in plain English. The paper ballot is then scanned and counted. Brad Raffensperger is Georgia's Secretary of State.
When you have a paper ballot, no matter how that really comes about, at the end of the day, you have the paper that you can do the audit from. And then you can audit the elections. That's something I think is more secure, because then we really capture voter intent.
But election security experts say that is not the case.
It's a computer, and you have no idea what's in the computer, and you have no idea what the computer is doing with the information that you give it.
Rich DeMillo is a professor of computer science at the Georgia Institute of Technology. He tried to stop Georgia from buying the Dominion system, now used in 24 states.
A ballot marking device is, in the first place, an extremely expensive pencil that will make mistakes, that is prone to failure, that is prone to misuse. And if it fails, if it's misused, you have no way of telling. If you use a ballot marking device, you don't have the original record of voter intent.
Are you concerned the system can be hacked?
No, we never take anything for granted. We are very vigilant. We understand that elections are tempting targets for hackers.
Indeed, At the hacker convention DEF CON, they have been making virtual mincemeat of electronic voting machines for years. Legendary white hat hacker and election security consultant Hari Hursti was part of the exploits.
You can introduce races which don't appear as when they should be. You can change the design on the screen to be misleading and confusing the voter. When the voter is making the selections, are those selections recorded accurately?
The new voting system also includes electronic poll books made by a St. Louis company called NoInk. Election officials say the devices frequently shut down and showed polling information for the wrong election, creating more havoc. But they also come with security concerns. They are iPads that connect to the internet to download the database of registered voters.
How big a concern is that?
It's a huge concern. If you can deny someone access to the voting machine, then you move that person away from voting at that place at that time.
It is a proven target. In the run-up to the 2016 election, Russian hackers successfully broke into voter databases and software systems in 39 different states. Rick Barron is the director of registration and elections in Fulton County.
Do you have any evidence that in the midst of this chaotic election, hackers took advantage of those vulnerabilities and may have tampered with this election?
I have no evidence of that.
You really don't have the bandwidth or the capability of looking.
No, I mean, we're all that we can do is set up our own security around our equipment to mitigate the risks to it. We have cameras on our building, we have alarms on our building, we have the server is locked away as well.
The experts all agree paper ballots marked by hand are the most secure, most verifiable way of voting. More than 1 million Georgia voters chose to do this at home this election. For those who didn't receive their ballots or chose to vote in person, the expensive, complicated, vulnerable machines created a huge bottleneck at polling sites, and there were many fewer of them. In Fulton County, 34 sites opted out because of COVID-19 concerns. With Democrats turning out 4-1 over Republicans, it was a recipe for scenes like this. Long lines of African-American voters. Corey Campbell waited 4 hours in South Fulton County.
I feel like they're just trying to discourage people of color or of minority to not vote, because that's the agenda that we're trying to push to especially younger people of color and minority. So it's very important. They know how important it is, so they'll do anything to throw a rock in the process.
With 4 to 5 million Georgians expected to vote in November, this primary election offers a stark warning of electoral chaos ahead.
I'll take you back to Georgia in just a moment for an update. This year, mail-in voting came to prime time, ready or not. In places where this has not historically been the routine, there are all kinds of logistical and legal barriers, making the tabulation of mail-in ballots a real nightmare. But in Ocala, Florida, it's just another election.
It's August 14th in Ocala, Florida, 4 days until a primary election, and most of the ballots have been cast. They roll in every day in bins from the post office, right past the office of Wesley Wilcox.
What's today?
Three.
Good deal.
Supervisor of Elections for Marion County.
If you'd asked me 10 years ago, if you'd asked me 5 years ago, or if you'd asked me 5 minutes ago, am I a proponent of vote by mail? I am. I like vote by mail.
And so do most Floridians. The state that became infamous for antiquated, ambiguous punch card voting during the disputed Bush versus Gore presidential contest 20 years ago has fully embraced early voting and absentee ballots for anyone who asks, including Palm Beach resident Donald Trump.
Thank you very much.
Who votes by mail while repeatedly trashing the process, suggesting it is rigged and rife with fraud.
All these ballots come in, these mailed ballots come in. The mail ballots are corrupt, in my opinion, and they collect them and they get people to go in and sign them, and then they're forgeries in many cases. It's a horrible thing.
The rhetoric is not supported by reality.
The Conservative Heritage Foundation maintains an online database of documented election fraud cases in the United States. It lists 204 cases of absentee ballot fraud with 143 criminal convictions over the past 20 years. On average, that's one case per state every 7 years, representing about 0.00006% of total votes cast.
A lot of the things that people talk about, vote by mail, just aren't reality. You know, you can't run down to the Wawa or the Circle K and pick up a handful of vote by mail ballots. It's just not there.
Amber McReynolds is CEO of the National Vote at Home Institute and Coalition.
And the reason it's exceedingly rare is that there's multiple steps and checks in the system that prevent it and would identify it if it were to occur.
McReynolds was director of elections in Denver when the state of Colorado left traditional Election Day polling behind in 2013. In Colorado, every active registered voter gets a ballot in the mail automatically. They can return the ballots by mail, at drop boxes, and a few choose to vote in person. Jocelyn Bucaro is Amber McReynolds' successor.
We only had about 1% of our voters in the state primary vote in person. So that, you know, tells us that, and we hope will be repeated in November, that voters will vote that ballot at home and use one of our secure methods to return it.
Bucaro and her team showed me how they do it. Ballot envelopes here are imprinted with an intelligent mail barcode, a number unique to each voter, which allows tracking through the mail. The envelopes are run through a customized mail sorter that is connected to the registration database. Drake Ramke is a project coordinator here.
So anytime I run this machine, it's got the most up-to-date information. So if somebody voted in person an hour ago, and then we get their mail ballot that comes through, it's going to be kicked out as void because they voted in person out front.
So it's real time.
Signatures are initially checked with software. About 20% are automatically accepted that way. The rest are verified, along with 2% of the machine choices to double-check its performance.
We do extensive training both internally, and then we bring in a handwriting expert that has worked with the FBI prior to every election to give more tips.
The envelopes are opened by machines to maintain the secrecy of ballots. Then they are fed into high-speed scanners to be tallied. Voters are instructed to carefully fill in the ovals. But on some ballots, 1.6% in the last election, they don't fill them in completely or use X's, checks, or other markings.
And in that case, the software will ask humans to take a look at that and say, is this a mark or not? And we have bipartisan teams of election judges who do that ballot adjudication.
Colorado is among 6 states that vote almost entirely by mail. But the COVID-19 pandemic has prompted others to consider ways for people to vote without spending a lot of time in line with strangers.
And I started getting a lot of calls, like, what would this look like? Could we scale this nationally?
She says yes, but not without difficulty. The June 9th primary in Georgia was a case in point. More than 1 million people voted by mail. The previous record was 35,000. This created chaos and confusion. Many voters didn't get their ballots in time and were uncertain that their votes were received and counted. That prompted Wanda Hayes to try a belt and suspenders approach. I met her waiting in a long line to vote in person.
Did you try to vote absentee?
I sure did.
What happened?
Well, I received my ballot and I sent it in, but I don't know if it was received or not. So
you want to make sure?
Yes, right.
Secretary of State Brad Raffensperger says 1,000 Georgians double voted in the June primary and August runoff. The announcement gave some traction to President Trump's critique of mail-in voting and his suggestion to supporters to try and vote twice. But Raffensperger warned the public that what the president is encouraging people to do is a crime.
Double voting is a felony. It's a minimum of 1 year in prison, up to 10 years, up to a $100,000 fine, and we will prosecute.
Back in Florida, Wesley Wilcox's team is taking this unprecedented election year in stride. They didn't break a sweat sorting, processing, and scanning ballots in the August primary. By election day, they only needed to push a button to tally the votes. But elsewhere, things are not running as smoothly. In Tennessee, the law prevents election workers from even opening envelopes containing ballots until election day. Several other states, including Michigan and Pennsylvania, have similar constraints. Wilcox is hearing a lot from his counterparts in places where they are struggling to answer the mail.
This is an extraordinary election. Are they all kind of freaking out?
You know, short answer, probably yes. But there's the election administrator prayer, you know, Lord, I don't care who wins as long as they win big. You know, and that's reality.
The reality is election night will likely be more like election week while we all wait for the envelopes, please. With all the attention this year on mail-in voting, less attention has been paid to the various computers that we use in this country to take and tabulate our votes. After the 2000 presidential election, flawed and contested as it was, Congress appropriated a lot of money for the states and local jurisdictions to modernize voting systems. Many of them purchased touchscreen systems, paperless devices that turned out to be very vulnerable to technological failures and hackers, and did not leave an audit trail behind. Today, we know that those systems create a real problem for election integrity, but they're still in use in some places. It's early on election day in Memphis, Tennessee. Commissioners from each party are working in pairs to unlock sealed steel boxes filled with absentee ballots.
This is this one says box 54 rejects.
Benny Smith is a Democrat.
You have one central lockbox that has a key for a Democrat, a key for a Republican, and nobody can get to the locks that unlocks the other locks unless you go through that chain.
In an August election like this, they would normally receive about 1,000 absentee ballots. But on this pandemic summer morning, they have 16,000 to process and tally. For Benny Smith, it's a COVID silver lining. Yeah, he is a big proponent of hand-marked paper ballots as opposed to voting machines.
I'm a fierce paper advocate. It is an authenticatable result because you have the voter's intent. It's hand-eye coordination, and that's my selection process.
But for Shelby County's Administrator of Elections, Linda Phillips.
I state your name.
The absentee deluge is a headache. Tennessee law prevented her from opening the envelopes until this moment, and there were all kinds of surprises.
This is the first time many voters in Tennessee have ever voted a paper ballot, and they did some really weird things to them. We had a large number of ballots where they would select a candidate and then they'd write the name in again. But there were some when we couldn't figure out what they wanted. One guy voted for 14 people in a race for one.
That vote didn't count. But bipartisan teams labored to determine voter intent as best they could. The tea leaf reading occurred in Shelby County's election warehouse, where they store the voting machines they use in polling places.
I think machines help voters do a better job. It eliminates a lot of the mistakes that we see on paper ballots. And I prefer machines because they're just more accurate.
Maybe, but it's impossible to know that for sure. Here in Shelby County, they use vintage 2000 devices made by Diebold Election Systems, a company no longer in business. These so-called direct recording electronic machines, or DREs, are paperless, making it impossible to verify their accuracy. They and the networked machines that compile and tabulate the votes are an easy mark for hackers, which they have publicly proven time and again, most famously by the white hat hacker Hari Hursti in the 2014 HBO documentary Hacking Democracy. In a demonstration, Hursti had little trouble flipping votes.
What is it? 7 yes, 1 no.
Oh my God.
In Memphis, efforts to buy new technology became mired in political debate and the pandemic. And yet few dispute the old machines are an Achilles heel.
Software and hardware ages in dog years mixed with jet fuel, right? A piece of technology 20 years ago, just like imagine a BlackBerry One or a flip phone or Sony Ericsson or something. If it's 20 years old, it's really outdated.
Benny Smith knows from experience. He's an information technology expert on computer security. The DRE machines came into vogue after punch card ballots created chaos in the 2000 Bush versus Gore election. By 2004,
nearly 1 in 3 voters in the U.S. use DREs. But as the security vulnerabilities came to light, most jurisdictions got rid of them. In November, less than 10% of Americans will vote using DRE machines.
The trend lines are solidly in favor of a complete elimination of DREs.
Chris Krebs is director of the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency at the Department of Homeland Security.
So we have a series of security controls that are in place that can harden those systems. But ultimately, when you think about the riskiest bits of election systems, election infrastructure, to exploit these kinds of machines at scale to change an election outcome, incredibly complicated.
But in New Hampshire, the Secretary of State has long believed the simple way to thwart hackers is to avoid using computers.
We became the first state in the country that actually had a law that said that every voter in New Hampshire shall vote on a paper ballot.
Bill Gardner has held the job for 44 years, longer than anyone currently in office in the nation. I followed him as he made the rounds on state primary day in September. He did not meet a stranger. It felt like I had stepped into a Norman Rockwell painting of 19th century town meeting halls.
When you became Secretary of State, were you a firm believer in the power and accuracy of paper ballots, hand-marked paper ballots?
I was a believer. I'm a lot more of a believer after all these years. The more moving parts you have to the election process, the more problems you're gonna have.
So you're old school and proud.
They have tried machines here before. In the late 19th century, every town got one of these. With a crank, gears, cylinders, and a bell, it counts ballots.
And you can see the counters?
Yeah, yeah.
0 to 9.
Right.
So it can get up to 999 ballots.
At that time, the concept of a secret ballot was relatively new in the United States.
Thank you.
Ever since, election officials have tried to preserve that secrecy while maintaining accuracy and security. But after all these years, there may not be a technological solution to that problem.
Technology is not always the answer, is it?
It's not been the answer with respect to elections, that's for sure. People have to have confidence. They have to have confidence that their vote counts. If you don't trust it, you're not gonna make any effort to be a part of it. Not only that, but you're gonna reject it.
In Memphis, Election Commissioner Benny Smith has similar worries. He says he cannot be certain whether votes captured on the old machines will truly count.
It's anybody's guess. Hopefully it's gonna count. As a sitting commissioner, obviously, I'm going to advocate for every accountable measure to make sure that it did. But it's not a great product for you right now.
This election year, there has been a lot of political rhetoric that raises questions about the integrity of our elections.
This is going to be the scam of all time.
But the people who know best how we vote say paper ballots marked by hand, whether mailed in or filled out at a polling site, should be the least of our worries.
Hand-marked paper ballots may be the safest and most secure way for people to vote, but they're not accessible to many people with disabilities. So election systems manufacturers devised a touchscreen device that allows people to vote even if they can't hold a pen or even see. But many jurisdictions are using these systems universally, and this creates a host of technological problems and complexity. And nowhere has this problem been more acute than in the place where we began our story, Georgia.
In Georgia, early voting turnout is high. The presidential race is a toss-up, and both Senate seats are in play. So naturally, the political world is nervously watching what voters here will do, while in the world of computer science, they are tensely tracking what the voting machines will do.
Georgia's kind of a petri dish.
Alex Halderman is a professor of computer science at the University of Michigan.
There's a lot more we have to learn about Georgia's election system, and that's going to help inform how to better secure elections, not just in Georgia in November, but across the country for years to come.
He's among a handful of independent election security experts getting unprecedented access to the inner workings of the state's $107 million voting system rolled out earlier this year. Also taking a deep dive, election security white hat hacker Hari Hursti.
They have set up a complicated system which is centralized and doesn't seem to have any safeguards.
Georgia's vote tallying system is a complex assortment of laptops, iPads, magnetic cards, touchscreens, printers, and scanners. Lots of moving parts.
This is the poll pad. On election day, it is used to check in voters.
Rick Barron is Fulton County's Director of Registration and Elections. He gave me a demo.
It tells whether we've issued an absentee by mail ballot, whether somebody's voted early, whether they've voted that absentee ballot, or whether they're still eligible to vote.
Once a voter is deemed eligible, the iPad activates a magnetic card, which in turn unlocks a so-called ballot marking device, or BMD.
This is a pretty complicated way to do something you could do with pen and paper. There are advantages here, right?
Yes. The advantages are puts a true mark on the screen.
When done, the voter prints a ballot. Selections are recorded in human-readable text and in a QR code, which is read and counted by an optical scanner. Georgia's Secretary of State, Brad Raffensperger, says this is more accurate than pen and paper.
The problem with pen and paper is sometimes you have your instructions on what you're supposed to do, but you end up with spoiled ballots. Sometimes people will put an X here, but then they'll circle this one here, or they'll make different marks on it. What did they really mean there?
Still, elections officials tell us they seldom see a hand-marked ballot where they can't determine voter intent. In 2019, Georgia bought the devices from a Canadian company called Dominion Voting Systems. They replaced paperless machines like these, made by a now-defunct company called Diebold Election Systems. A federal judge forced the state to scrap the discredited devices. Election security activist Marilyn Marks was part of the lawsuit that triggered the change. But for her, ballot marking devices, now used widely in 14 states, are not the ideal remedy.
We need paper records that are marked by the voter, with the voter's own hand, where we know that was recorded the way that the voter wanted it recorded.
So she and the other plaintiffs took aim at the new voting machines. The lawsuit came into sharp focus after their chaotic debut in the June primary. The poll pads took as long as 30 hours to download the voter database, displayed the wrong races, and would randomly shut down. And the power-hungry ballot marking devices blew circuit breakers in numerous locations. Poll workers, many of whom had no hands-on training because of the pandemic, were often befuddled by the new technology.
We've learned a lot of lessons. We're putting technicians in every single polling place. We have to make sure that not only do the poll workers know how to use the equipment, but then these technicians are then going to be relied upon to fix any issues. We want to just fly under the radar and do our jobs and, you know, stay away from the news.
But election security experts working for the plaintiffs in the lawsuit against the state have uncovered several troubling issues. Alex Halderman looked closely at the QR codes, where the votes are encoded for the scanner.
By analyzing the structure of the QR codes, I've been able to learn that there's nothing that stops an attacker from just duplicating one. And the duplicate would count the same as the original barcode.
And in late September, another concern came to light. During testing, election workers found half the names of the 21 candidates for Senate intermittently disappeared from screens during the review phase. Dominion sent out a last-minute software patch.
I'm worried that the Georgia system is the technical equivalent to the 737 MAX. They've just made a last-minute software change that might well have unintended consequences and cause even more severe problems on election day.
You never want to rush something which is mission critical, and this is mission critical, into production without proper time of testing. That's really one of the ways bad actors are finding the vulnerabilities to exploit is looking for honest vulnerabilities and finding out if they can be weaponized, if they can be exploited.
Despite all the concerns, federal judge Amy Totenberg decided to let the election proceed with the ballot marking device system. The Secretary of State says post-election audits will bring any QR code discrepancies to light.
We're in the process of really, you know, continue to expand the capabilities that we have so we can audit more of the races. When we do the audit, we actually do it on the human readable portion, not on the QR code.
Alex Halderman and his team at the University of Michigan conducted a mock election to see if voters are likely to catch mistakes on the printouts. Only 7% spotted a deliberately planted error. So double check your ballot before you scan.
So what happens after we vote and elections officials have tallied everything up? How can we be certain that we can trust the outcome? One way to do that is with a post-election audit. But typically, those audits are expensive and cumbersome, and depending how the votes are captured in the first place, they can be intrinsically flawed. But a mathematician in California has come up with a much simpler way to audit elections.
We try to be minimal waste in the kitchen. This is the carrot tops, carrot greens.
At his house amid the trees in the hills of Berkeley, California, mathematician Philip Stark is refining a recipe.
It's vegetable soup. It's a homemade stock from whatever leftover bones I'd accumulated.
For adding ingredients of trust and verifiability to elections in the United States. He's the originator of a big idea to make post-election audits much easier. It's called a risk-limiting audit, a technique that reminds him of cooking and tasting soup, or in the lexicon of mathematics, random sampling.
So what is a random sample, and why can you learn something about a big group by looking at just a small sample from the group?
After a good stirring, a tablespoon is all that he needs for a taste test.
I don't need to drink some fixed percentage of the pot to tell if it's salty enough. I need about a tablespoon, regardless of how big the pot is, if I stir it well.
Colorado was the first state to mandate risk-limiting audits in 2017. Nevada, Rhode Island, and Virginia have followed suit. In all, 46 states have some sort of auditing regime in place. But most are the traditional types, which require retrieving a much larger sample of ballots. We went to Brunswick, Georgia in September to see how a risk-limiting audit works outside the kitchen. It was a pilot audit of a state Senate runoff election.
And you have an audit board number. So your audit board 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Monica Childers showed the ropes to local officials. She's with a nonpartisan nonprofit called Voting Works, focused on building secure, open-source voting and auditing systems.
So whenever we go into a state, we try and do a number of local pilots of the process so the election administrators can get used to it, get their feet wet, and actually get experience with what we're doing.
3.
These audits typically begin with volunteer voters rolling 10 10-sided dice to generate a truly random number.
Why do we use dice? There are several reasons. First of all, we want the audit to be random. So we want unpredictability. We want genuine probability so that we can do probability calculations. But then we also want transparency and reproducibility and, to the extent possible, public participation.
9, 3, 1.
The random number is fed into Stark's formula or algorithm. So is the number of ballots for each candidate and the desired accuracy. The formula determines how many randomly selected ballots need to be located and double-checked in order to give certainty to the outcome. In an audit like this, the total number of ballots is not what's important. It's the margin between the candidates. If the margin is wide, only a very small number of ballots may need to be reviewed.
And at some point, it'll become convincing evidence that that entity, that person, that position on the ballot got more votes. You can't say ahead of time how many ballots you're going to have to look at in all because it depends on what you see.
So that is not actually confirming the margin necessarily. It's just confirming who won and lost, right?
Yes,
and that's
exactly
the important point here, right?
Absolutely. No, you hit the nail on the head. We are not auditing the exact count. We're just auditing the political outcome, who won.
In Glenn County's portion of the state Senate runoff, 8,814 ballots were cast, and the margin between the two candidates was 1,668 votes. They stopped the risk-limiting audit after locating and hand-counting 119 ballots. It was enough to give them 99.66% confidence that the outcome was correct. Monica Childers is confident the audit would have caught any meaningful discrepancy, no matter the cause.
It could be that an election was hacked. It could be that a tabulator developed a bug in the programming. It could be that the eye of the scanner got some dirt on it, and so it wasn't scanning as well as it was at the beginning of the process. It doesn't matter. Any of those things can be the cause of a tabulation error. If that tabulation error is great enough that it would have changed the outcome, a risk-limiting audit will catch it.
But will it? Georgia is among 14 states using a hybrid between paper and electronic voting machines. Touchscreen computers that print marked ballots. And with a computer between voter and ballot, there is no true record of what choices appeared on the screen or whether what's in the QR or barcode read by the tabulating scanner matches the voter's choices.
If ballot marking devices were used to mark the bulk of the ballots, then we're never going to know what the right outcome is. Even a full hand count of the paper isn't going to reveal that necessarily. That said, it's still better to audit than not to audit, right? We ought to check whatever piece of the process we can check.
Unlike the soup, which looked like a sure thing to me, although after tasting it, I thought of demanding a recount. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Miles O'Brien in Berkeley, California. Every election official I spoke with over the past 5 months impressed me with their nonpartisan professionalism. They just want to get it right. And they're keenly aware the people they need to convince the most are the losers and their supporters. To a person, they told me they don't care who wins, just so long as the margin is big enough that we don't get mired in doubt about the outcome. I'm Miles O'Brien. Thanks for watching. If you haven't voted already, what are you waiting for?